Today on Truth in Politics and Culture, the South Carolina Senate passes constitutional carry. The Biden administration continues to telegraph its strikes against Iranian-backed proxies. And a New York special election for Congress could predict how well immigration is working as an issue for Republicans. We'll also talk about Christians. Should they who oppose same-sex marriage, should they attend a same-sex wedding? All this and more on a Friday edition of TPC. This is Dr. Tony Beam, and it's time to crank it up. Good morning, everybody. Welcome into Back Patting Day. It's the day that you get to reach around, pat yourself on the back, and say congratulations because you've made it all the way to the weekend. Just got to get to 5 o'clock. Some of us have to get to 12 o'clock. And we got the weekend to ourselves, hopefully. So thanks for joining us on YouTube and Facebook this morning as we crank it up for another day. And we're going to try to get in some topics today that I think that you will enjoy. Just a quick reminder, today's Groundhog Day, which means that if Taylor Swift ever comes out of the Kansas City Chiefs skybox and sees her shadow today, we're going to have 6 more months of Taylor Swift and Swifties dancing around as we try to watch football. So that's kind of what Groundhog Day... Okay. Actually, it's Punxsutawney Phil. I get it. I can't even pronounce the guy's name. I mean, Punxsutawney, I think is right. Is we're waiting just in incredible anticipation here to see if a groundhog is going to see his shadow to predict what kind of weather we're going to have for the next 6 weeks. You know, it's going to be winter for the next 6 weeks. Here in South Carolina, we're going to have, I was looking ahead, we're going to be about where we should be this time of year. We're going to have some cloudy days. We're going to have some sunshine. We're going to have temperatures in the 50s during the day and down into the 30s at night. I think this is the last night was like the coldest that we're going to have for a little while, according to the next couple of weeks. And Phil really doesn't have anything to do with that, and neither does Taylor Swift. But don't tell the Swifties, because they actually think that Taylor Swift runs the world. And don't tell the Republicans, who have decided on this conspiracy theory that the NFL has rigged the Super Bowl so that the Kansas City Chiefs are going to win, and then Travis Kelce and Taylor Swift, their romance is going to be used to endorse Joe Biden for president, and that's going to be some kind of overwhelming thing that's going to be hard to overcome. And that's the conspiracy theory. I mean, that's George Soros is involved somehow with his money. And I guess he's influencing the NFL to that direction. And I really don't understand that. I don't understand why people are really talking about that. But I mean, Vivek Ramaswamy is out there saying that this is she's a psyop. That Taylor Swift is what I'm saying. She's a psyop for the CIA, for the deep state, and they're plotting all this to undermine President Trump. Well, the truth is, Taylor Swift was always going to vote for Biden. I mean, if anybody thinks that that's not on the table, I mean, she endorsed President Biden back in 2020. She came out in 2018, got involved in a race in Tennessee. Up until that point, no one really knew sort of what her political leanings were. She got a lot of push from progressives back in 2014, 2015, and through there, because she was writing songs that were kind of traditional songs about guys and girls who get into a relationship and then either move on and get married or they break up. I mean, she's very popular for the breakup songs, which, you know, she could have a mega breakup song if her and Travis Kelce don't walk down the aisle, because everybody's expecting that. But in any event, she's, you know, she was kind of known for that. And progressives were saying, look, that's too heteronormal. I mean, she's white, she's heterosexual. You've got to, and if that's you in the pop music world, then you have got to embrace left-wing critical theory political politics. I mean, you cannot be a white female and be popular in pop music, and because you're behind already. I mean, you're the only thing you got going for you on the critical theory scale is that you're female, and so she was being accused because of her music, because of the theme of the songs that she was singing, that she was heteronormal, and that just wasn't going to cut it with a lot of her fans. Now, a lot of the Swifties are fans because they actually like her music. I mean, it doesn't have anything to do with politics, which I think is why I'm not all that concerned about who she endorses for president. I mean, it's a celebrity endorsement. I mean, when have Republicans come out on top in celebrity endorsements? I mean, in terms of the number of them, most celebrities are lefties, and they're gonna endorse the Democrat Party. They're gonna endorse the progressives. So I'm not all that concerned. She did get she went on a voter registration drive, and she got like 35,000 people to register to vote that hadn't registered to vote before. But when you think about it in the context of how much influence she has, I mean, what? She's got hundreds of millions. I don't even know what the number is. I'll go back and call it a bazillion. She's got a bazillion followers on social media, and she gets 36,000 of them to register to vote. I mean, this is going to change the outcome of the election if she endorses Biden, and there's some big conspiracy theory behind it. Please, we've got a lot of things to be concerned about in this country. I don't think that unless you're a football fan and have to endure endless Taylor Swift celebration videos while you're trying to watch a football game, I don't think you have to be worried too much about Taylor Swift and who she's going to endorse. It's no big secret, and it's certainly, in my view, not a conspiracy, not something that we need to be worried about. All right, some good news coming out of South Carolina yesterday for Second Amendment enthusiasts, which I happen to be one of those. Constitutional carry finally passed in South Carolina. It passed the South Carolina Senate. This is coming from the Greenville News today. The Senate passed permitless carry. That's what some people call it, permitless carry. I call it constitutional carry because the Constitution says you have the right to keep and bear arms. And so, really, according to the Constitution, you should be able to carry a weapon if you so desire. It passed 28-15 on Thursday after hours of debate the day and the week before. I mean, I've been in Columbia. I haven't followed this bill specifically as much because the South Carolina Baptist Convention hasn't passed any resolutions that I'm aware of that are specifically for constitutional carry. And so I didn't really lean into this, but I followed it in the sense that I wanted to see what happened. And I thought the debate was fascinating because you would think here in South Carolina, I mean, the number of states, let me back up for a second here. The number of states that have constitutional carry, and as of the end of 2023, there are currently 27 states. I mean, I'll just run through them. Alabama, Alaska, Arizona, Arkansas, Florida, Georgia, Idaho, Indiana, Iowa, Kansas, Kentucky, Maine, Mississippi, Missouri, Montana, Nebraska, New Hampshire, North Dakota, Ohio, Oklahoma, South Dakota, Tennessee, Texas, Utah, Vermont, West Virginia, and Wyoming. Now, you have to be either 18 or older or 21 or older. And different states have different caveats about how they do it. It's going to be 28 states now because the bill that the Senate passed yesterday is going to have to go back to the House because they amended it, and so the House is going to have to concur. Now the House can concur, and the bill goes straight to the desk of the governor, who is anxious. Governor McMaster said he's ready. He's got his pen. He's ready to roll. He wants to sign this into law. And so we'll wait and see if the House goes along. If they change it in some way, it'll have to go back to the Senate, and the Senate will have to concur, and then it can go. Or if they don't, then it'll have to go to a conference committee. And, anything can happen once you put Republicans and Democrats on a committee and they sit down and try to hammer out differences. So this is H-3594, by the way. It's already passed the House, but again, because of its there's a couple of amendments, it's going to have to go through it again. Under current law, of course, in South Carolina, anyone can legally own a gun needs a concealed weapons permit that requires training to carry it publicly. By the way, I have a concealed weapons permit. I've had it for years. I think everybody knows that. I mean, I carry a weapon most places where I go. I observe the law. There are places where you can't carry a weapon, and I'm very careful to take note of that. Businesses that put up signs that say no concealed weapons, if I don't know that the business has one of those signs and I'm walking up and I see it, I turn around, I go back to my truck and I leave my weapon in the truck because I'm gonna abide by the law, mainly because it's the law, but also because if I get caught, then I lose my concealed weapons permit, which I guess really doesn't matter that much anymore since constitutional carry says you don't have to have a permit. I want to keep my permit though, because when I leave South Carolina, there are states that have constitutional carry that still require you to have a permit if you're from out of state to carry concealed. You know, so that's you don't want to lose your. It's going to cause me to keep my permit because when I travel, I want to be able to carry in states that recognize South Carolina's concealed weapons law. Of course, last session where they passed open carry. If you had a permit, you could openly carry. You didn't have to conceal. And by the way, I haven't seen a lot of people do that. I don't know about you, but, you know, just being around in South Carolina, I don't see a lot of people that are carrying a weapon that's visible. Seen a few, been in a restaurant, seen a couple of people carrying that. And we've talked about that. I don't want to go deep into that, but the reason that if I'm going to carry, I'm going to carry a concealed weapon is because I don't want the bad guys in a situation to know that I have the weapon. People say, well, if they see that you're carrying and they come in, then they're going to think twice before they start something. My argument is if they come in and they're going to start something and they've already decided they're going to rob the place or they're high on drugs or whatever the issue is, they come in, they see the person, they see who's carrying a weapon, and they shoot them first. I mean, I'd kind of like to have an advantage, okay? I kind of like to have, well, they don't know that I've got a weapon. They're looking around, they're nervous, and while they look one way, I can produce my weapon and maybe defend myself. But if they've already got their weapon in their hand and I've got to draw my weapon and they see that I'm carrying, I think that puts me at a disadvantage. Now, it's been, there are plenty of people that argue against that, and I get it. Arguments on both sides. And I don't, it's not a hill that I'm ready to die on. I'm just saying that I'm keeping my permit for the reasons that I've stated. But open carry, haven't seen a whole lot of that. Now, maybe we're going to see more of it now that we have constitutional carry, or that we're going to have it as soon as it gets to the governor's desk. The Senate included several amendments making the bill different from what the House had pushed. One of the amendments, by Senator Margie Bright Matthews from Colleton, she's a Democrat, will expunge all prior unlawful carry convictions upon successful application for expungement. She also successfully passed an amendment dismissing all pending charges of unlawful carry once the bill becomes law. So in other words, this is going to be a retroactive bill. The logic is if you can carry, if constitutional carry is the law and you've been caught up in illegally possessing or carrying a weapon, then we're going to wipe the slate clean for you. And it just never ceases to amaze me how it seems to me that progressives, and particularly in the Democrat Party, want to do away with laws and penalties. I mean, I get this. I mean, I guess there's some logic to this that, you know, you look back and say, well, if this is going to be the law, then we don't need to be holding people accountable that are that maybe were carrying in a manner that violated previous law. But why in the world is it that progressives want to just do away with the rule of law in so many cases? We're going to talk about a case today from Oregon where Oregon did away with all illegal drugs. And now they're having to shut down, essentially, the city of Portland. I mean, they're having to go in because of the fentanyl problem they've got in Portland and the fentanyl number of fentanyl deaths. They're having to take just absolutely draconian measures to try to climb out from under the fact that they decided that it would be a good idea to legalize all kinds of drugs in Oregon. So I've never understood, except that progressives tend to lean toward chaos and anarchy for some reason. I mean, they want the current system, I suppose, to be completely upended, and but replaced with what? I mean, that's always my question. We cannot live together in society without laws to protect us from bad actors. And it seems like progressives don't seem to worry about that as long as they've got the money to hire people to be their security. And so that fascinates me. Another amendment allows businesses to post signs prohibiting concealed weapons. I mean, they've already that's already the law. I mean, they put up a certain size sign. It's got a circle with a red circle with a line through it over a picture of a weapon. I mean, it has to be a certain size, and it has to be on every door of a business if you're going to prohibit somebody from coming in. Republican Senator Shane Massey of Edgefield proposed this amendment, and one that defines the places where someone cannot carry a gun, concealed or not, and specifies punishments for doing so. Now, this is my beef with any kind, whether it's concealed weapon, whether you have to have a permit, don't have to permit, have a permit, constitutional carry. Look, if we're going to have constitutional carry, there should be a very, very limited number of places where you, as someone who carries a weapon, have to leave your weapon aside. I mean, I don't understand passing a law that says, okay, we're going to be a society, we're going to be here in South Carolina, we're going to support constitutional carry, except over here, except over there, except where a business says no. I mean, if we're going to have a law that says you can carry a weapon, then unless you're talking about, I mean, I could see unless you're specifically allowing some people in a school setting that are teachers. Now, I'm all for teachers that have a permit to be able to carry a weapon in a school. It just makes sense to me. I mean, if a person is deemed responsible enough to educate our children, and they are trained, they know their way around a weapon, knowing that schools are often targets, and we have a school resource officer in most schools who can't be everywhere at once. Why would you not allow responsible adults who are responsible for teaching our children also take on the responsibility of protecting our children if somebody shows up with a gun? I've never understood that. So I get that. But, I mean, just anybody walking up to a school basketball game, football game, being able to carry a weapon. I mean, people get emotional at sporting events, for example. And we don't want, and sometimes that can cause them to do stupid things. And so I can see not allowing a weapon to be carried in that environment. But, you know, other places I just don't get. I mean, hospitals, for example. I mean, I guess there are people coming in through the emergency room. A lot of times there's a lot of emotion there. Maybe that's the argument about somebody who has a constitutional right to carry, to keep them out of a zone where there's a hospital or being able to enter a hospital. But so many of these places, to me and the businesses, it seems to me you should have to have a reason if you're a business to say that, but some reason besides, I just don't like the law. I mean, that's like, here's a law that says I can carry a weapon, and yet a business owner can say, well, not in my space. And I know it's his space, please. I'm not suggesting that businesses are not free to make decisions like this, but it looks to me like if the law is going to say you can and a business says you can't, there needs to be a good reason. It needs to be more than I just don't like the law, because the laws get passed by our legislators, and then our responsibility is to abide by them, and everybody's supposed to abide the same. But anyway, signs, businesses are still going to be able to do that. One of the most heavily debated amendments by Massey was put forth late into Wednesday night. The amendment's multiple provisions includes one to create a training program free to participants, available twice monthly in every county in South Carolina, put on by SLED. Senator Mia McLeod, who is an independent in Richland, said $5 million to $20 million for SLED training program was something she couldn't support because, of course, you always go back to lawmakers are consistently dismantling education, which is false. And what she means is that lawmakers continue to allow parents to have more control and more say-so over their children's education, and to progressives, parents being able to make those decisions is the destruction of education. Because obviously educators know better than parents about how their children should be educated. That's the mindset. And so that's where that argument comes from. She says we don't feed children for summer programs and we refuse to expand Medicaid. There's always a whole list of things that we're not doing that progressives say when we do something, we want to spend any money. No, we can't spend any money unless we go back and address their specific concerns. Well, that's not how a constitutional republic works either. So the training's not required. It's just it's going to be available. And I would encourage people to get training. I mean, I have a lot of training. I'm not a police officer, but I have possessed a SLED Level 3 card for a number of years, which means I have to know the laws. I have to pass competency with a weapon. I've got to be able to pass a several tests to be able to keep a SLED card. And I just find the training to be very helpful. I mean, I want to know what the laws are in South Carolina. I want to abide by them. And I recognize that if I'm carrying a firearm, I have the ability to take someone's life. And making that decision, I think, it's fine to have training. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm fine with constitutional carry. I've wrangled about that in my mind for a long time, but I get the argument. I want to lean toward what the Constitution provides, and the Constitution does provide the right to keep and bear arms. And so how is it that the government steps in between a law-abiding citizen and their right to be able to carry a weapon and put requirements? I think that optional training that's free, that allows people that really understand the responsibility of firearms to get training if they haven't had training, I don't have a problem with that. Now, I don't know how the House is going to respond to that. The best thing, which the governor suggested, is that the House just go ahead and pass this bill and send it to the governor so that we are able to get it. The Senate changed the age from 21 to 18. They dropped the age down to carry a concealed weapon. The amendment also adds an extra penalty for those who don't have a CWP and carry in prohibited places. Democrats and other organizations raised concerns throughout the week about the bill, from safety and training to domestic violence. And you know what? Don't give me the domestic violence argument. If you're getting ready to vote to expand alcohol service in South Carolina. Because here's the thing. Yes, South Carolina consistently ranks in the top 10 or just below in cases of domestic violence. But one of the main indicators or contributors, I should say, to domestic violence is the abuse of alcohol. South Carolina also is ranked 7th in the number of DUIs. So we got a lot of people drinking and driving on the highways. Now, I'm not trying to take us back to prohibition, okay? Please don't go away thinking that I'm saying no alcohol. But in a state where we have a problem with alcohol, where we have domestic violence that's high, where we have DUIs and people getting killed on the highway because people are drinking and driving in too big of numbers, when we have all of that, Why are we expanding access to alcohol through curbside delivery, home delivery? And I get it. People are like, no, no, no. We get to make those decisions. It's free will. People can decide whether they want to drink or not. And all we're doing is make. No, no, no. I'm not saying that a person shouldn't be able in our society, if they want to go out and have a drink. We've settled that issue a long time ago. Now, I don't drink alcohol. But I'm not saying that everybody has to make the decision that I've made. But I am concerned that we already have the right, but we just keep expanding access at a time when we're not being responsible under the laws that we currently have. It looks to me like we would want to think twice before we start delivering to the curb, before we start home delivery. And of course, the other thing that they're working on passing is to get alcohol sales on Sunday. And they want to do it by having a referendum in every county, in all these counties where alcohol sales are prohibited on Sunday. Well, we're going to turn it over to the people. We're going to get a referendum. There'll be votes in all these different counties. And a lot of people think, oh, that's a good idea. Let the people decide. Ladies and gentlemen, what Benjamin Franklin said to us about what we have is we have a republic. We don't have a direct democracy. We elect representatives who go make decisions, and we hold those people accountable. Because when you start having referenda all over the place, you start having this referendum over here and this referendum over here, well, then why have lawmakers? I mean, if that's what we're going to do, let's just switch over to a direct democracy and forget about the fact that we were given a constitutional republic, which, by the way, works a lot better than a direct democracy, because in a constitutional republic, you've got checks and balances so that you don't just have to have 50 plus one, and then everybody else has to live under whatever the 50 plus one decide, and there's no redress. So anyway, there's my soapbox lecture over it. It fascinates me when I hear our state lawmakers speak as if they've never understood basic civics, which is that some of them, I should say, not all, but some, and primarily progressives who want to just turn let's turn it over to the people. We've got our organizations have got a lot more money that they can spend to get our whatever point across that we want to get to sway the public. So let's just give every decision. Let's advocate our role and our responsibility here in Columbia and just hand it over and turn ourselves into a pure democracy. I've never understood that. I think that's a bad path to be on. So anyway, I know I'm chasing a rabbit here, but this is when I hear people start talking about, well, you know, guns are the real problem for domestic violence. No, I've never seen a gun jump off a shelf or escape from a gun safe or someplace where it's safely stored and go by itself and commit a domestic violent act. That's just not the way it works. It's the person that makes the decision in domestic violence, and oftentimes that person is influenced by drugs or alcohol. And yet we want to get into medical marijuana in South Carolina, which is a red carpet pathway to the legalization of recreational marijuana. That's what it's all about. And we want to expand alcohol, the things that hurt us as a culture and as a society. And we want to ignore the fact that Sunday is the Lord's Day. Now, that's another argument. And you know what? I get it. I'm a dinosaur. But I still think that in a culture, we were better off as a culture, I should say, when we actually respected the role of the church. And part of that respect was that the church has a day, Sunday, a day of rest and a day of worship. We should respect that. Because as a culture, when we say to people that it matters that religion is a part of our culture, then we do better. Even if you're not religious, maybe you don't believe, but you've got to admit that we're better off when people believe there's something greater than themselves and that they live by the teachings of the Bible and that they treat each other according to the way Jesus said that we're supposed to treat each other. That influence in the culture, in society, is a restraining influence that is a good thing. Why can't we support it? Why do we have to undermine the idea that there's one day that we leave alone because we recognize the value of religion, and particularly the value of Christianity to our culture? That's what I don't get. I mean, it matters what the state says about things because it sets an example. And so as these bills come up next week, I'm going to be urging lawmakers in the House to not expand opportunities for alcohol, either Sunday sales, curbside delivery, or home delivery. And a lot of it's going to be based on this idea of domestic abuse, which they're bringing up here in relation to constitutional carry, which I just don't, I don't think the constitutional carry is going to change the dynamic for domestic abuse, not near as much as just making alcohol and eventually marijuana much more available. All right, let's move on. I wanted to talk about the Biden administration today because I am speechless almost when it comes to the idea of the Biden administration continuing to telegraph its moves when it comes to whether they're going to respond to the fact that three American soldiers were killed and dozens injured in an attack. When we go after our enemies, it's not the best idea to tell them that we're coming, because then all we do is we end up bombing empty military facilities and warehouses. And what kind of message does that send? I mean, I think it tells the Iranian regime that we're not serious about retaliation, or we're not serious about protecting our soldiers who are stationed all over the Middle East. Now, this is coming today from Daily Wire. Commanders in Iran's Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps, which is a designated foreign terrorist organization, by the way, an FTO, have gone into hiding in Iraq and in Syria because President Biden's administration has repeatedly leaked their alleged plans to launch retaliatory strikes against those responsible for murdering three U.S. soldiers and wounding dozens more. CBS News reported that Biden officials confirmed to the network that plans have been approved for a series of strikes over a number of days against targets, including Iranian personnel and facilities inside Iraq and Syria. Now, you know, I can remember a day when, if military plans were revealed in advance, that could be considered treason. I mean, the United States military is going to take a particular action, and you tell everybody that you're coming so that you can move critical equipment and personnel out of the way. It doesn't make any sense. That doesn't send a message to Iran that we're serious about protecting American lives. It sends a message that says we're going to slap you on the back of the hand and then wait for you to come and attack us again, because that's what'll happen. You know, the Iranians need to believe that we mean business. If you remember when President Trump went after Soleimani, the Iranians stood down after that. You may remember when Israel, back in the 80s, when Israel took out a nuclear reactor in Iran. It was either Iran or Iraq. I think it was Iran. They stood down because the consequences were palatable. It meant something. Fox News correspondent Jennifer Griffin, who's been a pro-Biden, who has a pro-Biden slant to her reporting, responded to CBS report by noting that all of those IRGC commanders have already left Syria and gone into hiding, leaving those bases. The Pentagon usually does not telegraph so much if they want the element of surprise, she added. Well, duh. Of course not. I mean, you don't tell the enemy that you're coming and what you're going to do to give them the opportunity to disappear, so that there's no price here to be paid except some holes in the ground and a few buildings that get knocked down. The Biden administration further sought to diminish Iran's role in the more than 160 Iranian-backed terrorist attacks against U.S. forces in the region over the last few months telling Politico that they don't believe Tehran has full control of the terrorist groups that it funds. Tehran has control. Tehran determines how much money they get. They determine how much military equipment they get. And I guarantee you that these proxies, either Hamas or Hezbollah or the Houthis, whoever they are, they're not going to make a move unless the Iranian regime is going to back them up. Full control is irrelevant, said policy expert Norman Raoul. Tehran has the capacity to choke off weapons, that's the point that I was making, to militias, and highly likely the ability to halt action by major groups that rely upon Tehran for a significant financial and political support. Look, this is like a mob hit for Iran. I mean, you've got the Godfather is Iran in this scenario. And you don't put out hits on rival gangs without the Godfather's approval. And that's the same thing here. You don't, these proxies are not going to go out and attack anybody unless they know that their protection, which comes from Iran, is supporting them. Politico also reported that the Biden administration blames Israel for Iranian-backed terrorist groups attacking U.S. forces, saying that if Israel stopped trying to kill Hamas terrorists inside Gaza, who carried out the October 7th attack, there would be at least a tactical pause in the region by all Iran-backed groups. Yeah, that's a great plan. Appease the murderers. Make them know that there's not going to be a price to pay, or if the price gets too high, we'll stop paying it. That's going to go a long way into keeping this from happening again. The Israelis know that the only security that they have is to dismantle Hamas, to kill as many as the terrorists as possible, to get rid of that terrorist tunnel network that's in Gaza, and to not allow the return of Hamas once all of this is over. And the Biden administration understood that in the beginning, but they're getting pounded by progressives, and President Biden's beginning to worry that this is going to affect his reelection chances. So now he's backing off, and he's trying to shift the blame to the victims in this case, which are the Jewish people that are the victims of Hamas's attacks. Now, are Palestinians being hurt in this? Yes. But it's not because Israel is targeting them. It's because Hamas is hiding among them. It's because Hamas is an organization that's willing to put missile batteries near hospitals, in schools, in mosques, and they're willing to do all of that in order to take public opinion and to pressure Israel's allies into abandoning them. And unfortunately, it's beginning to work with the Biden administration. And folks, I talked about this early on. I said as soon as the pressure gets ramped up, I mean, in the beginning, Biden was very strong, but standing behind Israel for about a month. And then as these protests began to erupt across the country, which, by the way, is a global organization. I mean, it's not just people who are protesting against Israel in the United States. They were protesting all over the world, and a lot of these protests are coordinated by progressives, by people who are steeped in critical theory, steeped in Marxism, and they work together in order to disrupt the world order that we have, because that's what they want. And so now the Biden administration is beginning to back off of all of that. Secretary of State Lloyd Austin was asked on Thursday about the IRGC commanders fleeing back to Iran to avoid being killed by U.S. forces. Quote, has there been too much telegraphing, or is the point not to kill any Iranian commanders? What a great question. I think we know the answer to that. Yes, there's been too much telegraphing. And yes, the point is not to kill Iranian commanders, because the Biden administration is afraid of offending Iran. They think that that's going to expand the war, when actually not taking on the Iranian commanders is what's going to expand the war in the Middle East, because the Iranians can smell fear and they can smell appeasement. Here was the answer. In terms of telegraphing about strikes and whether or not people leave or would have left, you know, I won't speculate on any of that. He doesn't have to, because it's logical. I mean, it's clear. I will just tell you that, you know, we will have a multi-tiered response. And again, we have the ability to respond in a number of times depending on what the situation is. Man, that is political doublespeak. And it's very dangerous when it comes from the Secretary of State. Their policy is about as clear as mud. And there is no policy, no rational policy. Senator Tom Cotton slammed the Biden administration on Thursday for tipping off Iran and its terrorist groups on the U.S. military's plan response, saying that it was a reflection of Biden's policy of fear and appeasement and conciliation. Just like with Ukraine and before that with Afghanistan, he's scared of his own shadow, Cotton said. He keeps worrying about escalation. What we saw over the weekend was a massive escalation by Iran. The Biden administration seems to not be concerned when the escalation leads to the death of American soldiers and the maiming of American soldiers. But he's worried that any action that we take would be an escalation. And the Iranians know that, and that's why they continue to get away with this. The only way to solve that threat is to directly target Iran's terrorist forces throughout the region and in Iran itself to make it clear that we will never tolerate the deaths of our fellow Americans. That's exactly right. But don't look for that during the Biden administration, because I'm convinced that we're not going to find it. All right, I want to talk about this election that's coming up in New York, because it's important in that Republicans have such a slim majority right now in the House. And the election that I'm talking about is a House race that involves the expulsion of Santos from Congress. You may remember, of course, that George Santos was kicked out of Congress. He's the first person in Congress to actually be thrown out of that body. With all the charges against him and the lies that he's told, I get that. But it was bad for Republicans, because that was a pickup seat in New York. And now House Republicans are banking, and this is according to Politico, but House Republicans are banking on border security being key to keeping their majority. In New York right now, immigration is a hot button item because of all of the immigrants that have landed in New York. And you can thank, in part, the governor of Texas, Governor Abbott, and others who have been sending illegal immigrants that have been released into the interior. They've been given passage to New York because New York called itself a sanctuary city, and Republican governors decided to take them up on that. And, of course, now the pressure is being ramped up because of all of the pressure that these illegals are putting on the system in New York City. I mean, you've got buildings being converted to house them. You've got schools where students are told not to come to school because of the cold temperatures. They turn their school into a refuge for illegal immigrants that are essentially on the street because New York doesn't have the resources to be a sanctuary city. And then they have to tell the students when they come back to school after the temperatures begin to go back up so that the illegal immigrants can be back out on the street, they bring the students back in and they tell them to bring cleaning supplies with them because they're probably not going to get the school completely clean before they're able to. They're supposed to clean it up, but it may not be. So come back to school prepared, essentially. This kind of stuff is going on in New York, and this is why Republicans are banking on immigration, which is on the minds of a lot of voters, and particularly in New York, to try to win this seat. Here's more of the story. Outside a sprawling migrant shelter last week, Ethiopian-born Maisie Philippe introduced herself to reporters as a legal immigrant before identifying herself as a GOP congressional candidate. She then linked Democrat Tom Suozzi. Suozzi is where I'm going to go with that, because that's what something may be silent in there, but if you pronounce it like it's spelled, Tom Suozzi, her opponent in the race to replace George Santos. Facing cameras in the same spot moments later, Suozzi delivered a rebuttal arguing that Republicans are politicizing the issue instead of solving it. So this is going to play out over the next 9 months. This argument, this is the first time that we're going to see how these two arguments move voters in this district. Because it's in a place where they're having some serious problems with illegal immigration and illegal immigrants. And you've got one candidate, the Republican, who is an Ethiopian, who is stepping up to the plate and saying, look, we've got to solve this problem that the progressives are creating, and I'm the one that's going to solve it because I'll be in Congress to support border security and a program and a policy that will fix what's broken about immigration. That's going to be the Republicans' strongest argument, particularly in this district. But the Democrats coming along, and they're trying out the Democrat rebuttal, which is, no, Republicans don't really want to solve this issue. If they did, they would go along with a compromise deal that the Senate came up with. But instead of that, they're listening to their candidate, Donald Trump, who's telling them that instead of fixing the problem, he wants to run on the problem for president during this election cycle. And you're going to hear this over and over. That's why this race is particularly interesting to me, because I want to see how the people respond. Now, there's a lot of elements that go into it other than just that argument that we'll have to take in consideration. This thing's coming up February 13th, and then we're going to find out. But the Democrat candidate has outraised, I think it's 3-1 spending right now. The Democrats spending 3-1 on television in New York, in mailers, Felipe's got about, let's see, I was looking at the numbers. Hang on just a second. Because let me pull up the numbers here. There's another story. Yeah, here we go. Here's some of the numbers in this New York race. Former Representative Tom Suozzi raised $4.5 million from October 1st of last year through January 24th. That's according to the FEC, Federal Election Commission. That's more than triple the $1.3 million GOP nominee Mazie Philippe raised over the same period, and it helped to give Suozzi and Democrats a leg up on the pricey New York airwaves in the run-up to the February 13th special election. Suozzi also outspent Philippe $2.4 million to $714,000 through January 24th. But as of last Wednesday, Suozzi still had more money on hand for the stretch run of the race, $2.2 million to $629,000 for Philippe. Look, it still matters. Money still matters in politics. So even though Philippe may have the message, it may not mean that if she loses that message is a loser. It may just mean that she couldn't raise enough money because she's a newcomer to politics. Between the surge of migrants to New York City, more than 170,000 since April of 2022, and the infrastructure of the hyper-organized Nassau County Republican Committee, Democrats find themselves on the defensive. This is our seat to win, Representative Anthony D'Esposito, a Nassau County Republican, said in an interview. This is going to be the message that is sent across the country and to Minority Leader Hakeem Jeffries that perhaps they should be investing their money somewhere else in the general. So Republicans they're really counting on the strength of the message to overcome the fundraising and the spending advantage of the Democrats to be able to win this seat. And, of course, they've got to overcome the fact that Santos was kicked out of Congress because of his illegal actions and unethical behavior. That's another hill that they're going to have to climb. And this thing's going to come back to other seats in New York. Democrats believe if they can win this seat, that's going to give them a leg up when it comes to winning other seats for Long Island. This is what Democrats are saying. This race sets the tone for Long Island. It sets the tone for New York State. It sets the tone for the battle for the House, said Zach Malmed, a former House candidate who endorsed Suozzi. Some are describing this race as the Alamo for Nassau County Democrats. And they're hoping that if they flip this seat in this special election, that's going to be the path to them flipping these other seats in New York. I think there are six of them. And if they flip half of those, it's going to make it harder for the Republicans to maintain the House in 2024. So it's just going to be interesting to look and to see what exactly how that messaging works and whether or not the money can overcome the messaging. All right, let's see what else we've got here. Oh, I wanted to talk about this situation out of Oregon. Oregon decriminalized hard drugs in 2020. Now, what would you think that that would mean? Well, according to Jarrett Stepman over at Daily Signal, there's a price to be paid for bad policies. And when those bad policies are divorced from human nature, then the price becomes higher. That's exactly right. The Associated Press reported Sunday that Oregon's first-in-the-nation law to decriminalize hard drugs is finally facing serious backlash. This may come as a surprise, but according to the AP, the state has seen an explosion of public drug use fueled by the proliferation of fentanyl and a surge in deaths from opioids, including those of children. Stepman asked, who could have seen this coming? I mean, everybody could have seen it coming. You're going to legalize hard drugs? You're just going to allow people to shoot up wherever they are? Measure 110, passed by the Oregon legislature in 2020, decriminalized several hard drugs. It also set up a fund with taxes from cannabis sales to invest in recovery. Now, let me just stop here for a second. How insane is this exactly? You're going to take money that they're making off of recreational marijuana, and they're going to invest it in programs to help people get off the hard drugs that they've decided to decriminalize so that they can get on to the hard drugs. That is progressive thinking that is so twisted that it's impossible to understand. Residents caught with under a gram of heroin are subject to a ticket and a maximum fine of $100. That's barely more than the cost of a parking ticket in Portland. Those caught with small amounts of drugs can have the citation dismissed by calling a 24-hour hotline to complete an addiction screening within 45 days. But those who don't do a screening are not penalized for failing to pay the fine, even. In 2021, according to the AP, only 1% of people who received citations for possession sought help via the hotline. That's amazing, right? I mean, we should be shocked to learn that people caught using heroin aren't following through on some type of commitment to get them off of the heroin that the state now says is a good idea for them to use. The situation is so bad that some Democrat state lawmakers are considering rolling back the drug decriminalization law. State Senator Kate Lieber, a Democrat who co-chairs a new joint legislative committee created to tackle addiction, said everything is on the table. We've got to do something to make sure that we have safer streets and that we're saving lives. Yeah, having fentanyl on the streets because we have an open border, which is also a progressive idea, but then progressives come along and say it's fine to have fentanyl on the streets. It's fine to have heroin out there. And then they realize that people are dying, that the streets are dangerous. Portlandia, that's what we need to refer to Portland. I mean, it's basically in a different world. It's been absolutely hit with, as Stepman says in this article, a perfect storm of bad policies. In June 2020, the city defunded the police following the death of George Floyd and the custody of Minneapolis police. It was then rocked with nearly 200 days of protests, most of them violent. Portland was in anarchy. Violent crime exploded to an unprecedented extent. And of course, Portland now struggles to staff its beleaguered police department despite pivoting and refunding the police. So they defund the police, and then they decriminalize drugs, and then they sit around in meetings in Oregon and go, what's happening to our streets? With just 1.26 officers for every 1,000 residents, the Portland Police Bureau ranks 48th among the nation's 50 largest cities for its staffing to population ratio. As a result, PPB struggles to provide even basic service, taking up to half an hour to respond to high-priority calls. Well, what difference does it make for them to respond to a high-priority call if the call is about drug use? Because drug use is okay. Violent crime and a lack of police is only part of the equation. Oregon's drug decriminalization and Portland's toxic drug culture are making things much worse. Quote, all roads in downtown lead to fentanyl, said David Bayer, a member of the Portland Police Bureau's bike squad, in an interview with Fox News. Whether that's stolen cars, whether that's burglaries or thefts or organized retail theft, there's almost always a fentanyl nexus. So we spend a lot of our time currently policing fentanyl and trying to stop the flow. See, why am I spending time on this? I mean, I get it. People are probably going, look, that's Oregon. Why do we care? We should care because this is not just Oregon. This is happening everywhere progressives get power. We turn cities, states, over, we turn them into blue states. We give progressives carte blanche. And what happens? They defund the police. They decriminalize drugs. They turn a blind eye to shoplifting, to crime in the streets. And it causes people to start leaving in droves. Because they're, and I saw a story yesterday. I can't remember the city. I believe it's San Francisco. There's been a Denny's there for 45 years. And now they're closing because of the crime rates. I mean, it's common sense to those of us who read this stuff that you put all these policies together and you're destroying the culture and society that is the order of culture and society that's needed to hold it together. But for progressives, they don't see it. And if we turn this country over to another progressive administration, 4 more years of Biden-Harris, this is the kind of stuff that we're going to see on a national scale. It really is an amazing thing to behold. All right, let's see if we got another. I want to get one more story in here today before we go. You know, we were talking about. I said we were going to talk a little bit today about same-sex marriage and whether or not Christians should go to a same-sex wedding. What has gotten this conversation going is Alistair Begg. Now, Alistair Begg he does a radio program called Truth for Life, and on that program, he was talking to a grandmother who called in for advice about whether or not to attend her grandson's transgender wedding. And Alistair Begg basically said, well, here's the thing. Your love for them may catch them off guard, but your absence will simply reinforce the fact that they said, these people are what I always thought, judgmental, critical, unprepared to countenance anything. And so Alistair Begg basically said, look, go to the wedding. You can make your beliefs known about how you feel about same-sex marriage, but go to the wedding and actually take a gift. And that opened up a firestorm. And then, in fact, the radio show and Alistair Begg had to put out a statement saying that they didn't endorse. Let me just read the statement. Alistair's advice to the Inquirer was that of a grandfather, Mr. Begg, seeking to help a believing grandmother maintain a relationship with her unbelieving grandchild and was in no way an endorsement of the unbiblical ceremony. Well, look, I don't think we need to throw Alistair Begg under the bus because of this one conversation. Alistair Begg has been a stalwart, and his teaching, his Bible teaching, his preaching, his holding true to Scripture, but I think he's wrong in this case, and I think it's important to point out why. When you go to a maybe this is a bad example, but I'm going to use it anyway. Let's say that you've got a gay friend who plays on a local softball team, and you go to the game to support them. You're going because of your friendship, and your presence at a baseball game is to support them, or a softball game, is not necessarily endorsing their choices. But when you go to a wedding, you're not just a participant. People forget this. Weddings are for the people who come. They are, well, I should have said you are a participant, not just a spectator, because you're celebrating the fact that these two people are coming together to develop or to and to enter into a relationship. And when you show up at that ceremony, you're saying that this relationship has validity. I'm here to celebrate it. And there's no way that you can not represent that when you show up to a ceremony that's a same-sex marriage. And so I don't see how a Christian can go to a same-sex wedding without compromising their testimony, without compromising the fact that the Bible speaks of marriage, and it's not just, we're not just talking about Christian marriage here. We're talking about marriage as an example of the love that Christ has for the church. And you undermine that if you also undermine the idea that God's identity, God chose to make us male and female. And that identity, which runs throughout the scripture, we can talk about all the scripture that talks about the sin of homosexuality, but the basic foundation of scripture is that we're created in the image of God, and God made them male and female. And so that if you go to the wedding as a Christian, you're undermining God's definition of marriage. You're undermining God's the identity that God has given us as male and female, and it's going to weaken your Christian witness, because it's going to cause it. It doesn't strengthen it. It's because people are going to look out there and say, "Look here, if you're known as a believer, and they look out and see you, others look out and see you at a same-sex wedding, then they're going to come to the conclusion that you have decided to step over and be supportive of same-sex relationships." And if you're going to follow God's word, if you're going to stick to the biblical witness of what marriage is, the definition of marriage by the definition given by God is between a man and a woman. Regardless of what the Supreme Court says, regardless of what the culture says, that's what God says. And as Christians, our responsibility is to go by what the scripture teaches, not by what the culture condones. And so that's why I just think, again, I think Alistair Begg was wrong about this. Doesn't make him a bad person. Doesn't mean you should never listen to him again. I know all these people that have been critical are saying, well, if he's wrong about this, what else is he wrong about? Anybody that preaches or teaches or think about me, for instance. I mean, I've said things on this program that I've had to go back and correct. Because when you do, back when I was doing radio, I mean, it was 2 hours a day, 5 days a week. That's a lot of stuff coming out. It's a lot of talking. And I'm still an hour a day, Monday through Friday. There's going to come a time when you are going to make a mistake, or you're going to say something that maybe you haven't thought all the way through. And that's why I don't think we need to throw each other under the bus over one instance. Now, if he comes out and starts, you know, celebrating or doubling down on going to same-sex marriage, I think that's a problem. But as it is, we need to learn as Christians to give each other some space for grace, to give each other mercy instead of condemnation. And I think in cases like this, while we hold to the truth, and the truth is that Christians participating by going to a same-sex wedding, you cannot go without approving what's taking place. That's just the nature of the ceremony itself. All right, I hope you have a wonderful weekend. Sorry the show ran a little bit long today, but hope the weekend is good for you. My grandson's got a basketball game tomorrow, so I know where I'm going to be, and I'm hopeful that it's going to be good weather for the weekend that you can get out and enjoy. And I will see you on Monday morning at 7:30. Don't forget, the podcast will be up in about an hour. If you follow me on the podcast, please leave me a good review. and tell others that the show is worth listening to. God bless you. Have a good one.